So welcome to Australian Fatima. It's fantastic to have you here. What I'm keen to know about is some of the work you've been doing in advocacy for women with metastatic breast cancer. We know that's an area where the women in Australia face lots of challenges, and you've got a worldwide perspective on that. So can you tell us what you've been discovering?
Sure. I think all over the world these women face a lot of challenges, and one of the major challenges is lack of specific support for them, since their needs are substantially different from early breast cancer. And so this is something we've been working on, developing support, be it in information, be it in communication, capacity to communicate with the physicians and the nurses and all the team. And the other way around, also teaching physicians and nurses how to best communicate with this specific group of patients. And also fighting stigma, which is something that still exists a lot regarding cancer in many areas of the world, and specifically metastatic cancer, I would say, all over the world. So this has led us to start developing the guidelines, a dedicated conference, and coming from that, increasing the advocacy work of the conference, creating the ABC Global Alliance, which is meant to be a platform for everyone who wants to develop projects dedicated to metastatic disease or to advanced disease. So we aim to get everyone on board and to learn from each other, because in some countries there are projects already ongoing that have been successful, so we don't have to start over, but we can learn from each other, and also from projects who did not work.
Okay, so you're not reinventing the wheel of things that, you know, really are not appropriate for this group of women.
Yeah.
And as you've been familiar with, of course, breast cancer in men is much less common, but also can occur as metastatic disease. Can you tell us a little bit about the work you've done to bring together information and support for men with metastatic breast cancer?
So, actually, we have spoken about the stigma, and stigma around breast cancer, even early breast cancer in men, is still very much out there. So we have created, with the support of BCRF, we have created the Male Breast Cancer International Program to try to understand better this disease, which represents only 1% of breast cancer. And for men with metastatic disease, it's even rarer, so we actually don't know how to treat. They have been excluded from most of the trials. Only now, recently, with the new drugs available, they have been allowed to enter the trials. So we have a lot to learn about the biology of the disease, understanding if it's really the same, and also if we can treat as we have been doing, extrapolating from the female breast cancer. So a lot of work ahead.
And some of those men, I think, will come from families where there are BRCA mutations, so they may in fact share some of the features of that group. Can you comment on any treatment advances for people who've got metastatic disease and BRCA mutations?
So I've been waiting, as you know, a long time to have some positive results in that group. So finally this year, we had the first PARP inhibitor trial with a drug called olaparib that showed a benefit. I wouldn't say that it's a huge benefit, but it's the first benefit that we see with a drug that is directed to the BRCA mutation. So we are very hopeful that more will come around that, and that will be very important.
That's right, and that's a drug that will be available in Australia probably by later this year, specifically for people who have those mutations. So it will be something for women to ask their oncologist if they haven't been tested. If that's appropriate, it could then be done.
Exactly, and also, I don't know if it's available in Australia, but for women with ovarian cancer, it's already available in some countries, where it showed even more interesting results that also related to the work in
nutrition attachments, yes. So the other group of new drugs that we're hearing about in Australia and have been involved with testing in clinical trials are called CDK inhibitors, so palbociclib, ribociclib and abemaciclib are gradually making their way through the approval process here. They've been received a fair amount of attention and hype. Do you think that they really represent a significant advance?
I sincerely hope so. The reason I'm saying this is because we're still waiting for some results, particularly overall survival results, but they do have two very important characteristics. They are very well tolerated, and this is very important in a disease like metastatic breast cancer, where you need to take treatment for long periods of time. Actually, you need to be on treatment almost all the time, so having something that is very well tolerated is very important. I would say in particular the first two, palbociclib and ribociclib, are very well tolerated, and they have shown that in combination with endocrine therapy, they can stabilize the disease for a long period of time, so on average 2 years or more being stabilized. So that's time without chemotherapy.
And by itself, time out of the clinic, time out of the hospital.
Giving, receiving oral treatment, so both oral treatment. We can use also with fulvestrant, that it's an injection, an intramuscular injection, but you can also use with other types of endocrine therapy that are oral. And so an all-oral option, well-tolerated, that will give a long period without chemotherapy. If they also show a survival benefit, I think we may be close to having, with this type, subtype of breast cancer, what we saw with HER2-positive disease. And that I would really would like us to see that, because in this what we call luminous, hormone-dependent breast cancer is the most frequent one. And so if we could have really a breakthrough and a step forward in the survival, it would mean a lot to many, many women.
That's right. So more people potentially could gain. And the challenge really, in Australia at least, is getting funding for them through the PBAC. So the oncologists and BCNA have been working together to try and secure that. And we're hoping to hear some positive news perhaps by the end of the year. It's also the case, I think, that avoiding the tied down aspect of having intravenous chemotherapy that allows people to work and to travel and get on with their normal lives may well be a big advantage of these drugs. So for women with hormonal breast cancer, is it something they should be asking their oncologist about?
I think they should, yes. Even if we have all these problems of accessibility, and it's not just in Australia. I think we need to start doing cost-effectiveness studies that take into consideration what you just mentioned, that are sometimes called indirect costs. So it's not the drug only, the cost of the drug, but what you save in terms of not traveling so often to the hospital, what you save in nurse time, that you are not in the day hospitals. All that has to come into account in terms of the cost of a treatment versus the other. And so it will be important that BCNA and also women pressure those who take the decision so that the correct cost-effectiveness studies are performed.
And you mentioned just now that the HER2-positive breast cancer, which we see in about maybe 15% of women with metastatic disease, really does seem to have taken a big leap forward in the last couple of years, and we're very fortunate that working together with BCNA we've been able to ensure that a good range of HER2 blocking drugs are available to women in Australia. What do you think that we're going to be seeing as the next step forward for people with HER2 positive disease?
I think the biggest challenge there is to understand the best sequencing. We do have several good treatments. We are using several of those, or at least we're starting to use several of those in the early setting. Now we need to understand if we use them in the early setting, what is the best sequencing we're using in the metastatic setting. So I think that will be one of the challenge, because those studies are very difficult to perform. And the second thing is that there are new treatments coming, new anti-HER2 treatments coming. Some of them already in phase 3, some others entering the phase 2-3. So we will see if they can improve, or at least if they can show a benefit after the others that are already there. Because fortunately, these women and men, much rarer in men, the HER2 positives, but these patients are living now even 10 years with the disease. So they need several options of treatment to be able to control the disease even further than 10 years. So I think it's a very exciting subtype of
breast cancer. Again, if you've got HER2 positive breast cancer, good option might be to talk to your oncologist about whether there are trials available, because if you receive a drug as part of a clinical trial, it means that you haven't lost one of your other options.
Exactly.
You've still got that up your sleeve, so it can extend.
So always an additional option of treatment that, and besides, you'll be helping to shape the future of the management of that.
That's right, we'll be learning at the same time. So we haven't talked yet about triple negative breast cancer, except to say that that does sometimes link with BRCA mutations. What about for those women? Do you think that we've got the optimal chemotherapy yet, or do you think there's more to come?
Well, I think that the future there lies into subdividing this subgroup. So basically, we are calling triple negative to everything that doesn't have one of the other positives. So it's not estrogen receptor positive or HER2 positive. So we call all of that triple negative, but there are many subtype being within the triple negative, at least between 7 and 10. So this could be 7 different diseases, and maybe we'll find something positive to define each of those subtyping that would allow us to develop specific treatments. So I think we had a disappointing news this year. There is a class of drugs called AR, androgen receptor inhibitors. So it's another type of receptor, which is overexpressed in a subgroup of triple negatives. And there were several trials ongoing. They were stopped because the drug was bought by another company and they are rethinking everything. I hope they don't stop, because it it's an oral drug, well tolerated, that could be a good solution for a subtype of the triple negative. So as you mentioned, the PARP inhibitors, maybe for another subtype, and so forth. I think optimizing chemotherapy is not going to be easy to do. We already have very good chemotherapy agents, and I'm not sure we can improve a lot more. But I think understanding what defines this subgroup and developing targeted agents will be the future for treatment.
There's been a lot of interest in Australia in immunotherapy because in the melanoma world, of course, immunotherapies have really transformed the lives of many people with metastatic disease, and of course Australia's been very involved in those trials. What's your take on the role of some of the immune therapies in metastatic breast cancer?
I have to say I'm not a very huge fan of immunotherapy for breast cancer. I think, again, we will need to understand very well what is the subgroup that eventually will derive a benefit. I think there's a lot of hype around immunotherapy. And breast cancer is a very complex tumor, more complex perhaps than melanoma. There is not just one driver of the disease. So sometimes I call breast and prostate like complex solid tumors that are capable of hiding away from our immune system. So immunotherapy as it is being used today might not be sufficient. But there is a lot of research, very good research, some of them here, some of it here in Australia, trying to understand how can you help the immune system to identify the tumor cells. And if you do that, then you can increase the efficacy of immunotherapy. So I think we're still lacking a lot of understanding for immunotherapy. And what I would tell people is to, if there are trials, clinical trials, that's certainly a very good option. Outside clinical trials, I would caution the use of immunotherapy agents in breast cancer.
So it's been my impression with them in treating my patients with melanoma that there's no free lunch. And these are drugs which can have significant side effects when you turn on the immune system and make it angry at the cancer. It often gets angry at other things as well, and they certainly need to be administered by people who are very experienced in looking after.
Absolutely.
Because of the different sorts of side effects often from chemo. So as we're going to just wrap up here, Fatima, what about supportive care? You mentioned that at the outset. Are there things that women should be asking their oncologists to help them with in terms of their supportive care?
I think absolutely, and there's around the world there's a lot of confusion between supportive and palliative care, and people often think that equal to end of life discussions, and not at all. There are a lot of things that can be done from the beginning of the disease, and supportive care should be seen as something that allows us to give all the treatments that we have. So, and at the same time improve quality of life. So we will include in that the new treatments for nausea and vomiting, which are improving every year. Also, the scalp screening is now being used much more
to prevent hair loss,
which is something very important, obviously, for the quality of life. And I would say that the fact that people are recognizing the issue, the complexity of the emotional support that these patients need, and not them only, but also the families, and the inclusion of the psycho-oncologist in the team and the support from the beginning is really crucial. And as you know, and you're very interested in that, the communication, and keep talking about this, because I feel that if you don't have a good communication with your team that it's taking care of you, you will not be able to voice your preferences, to voice your fears, and so that is an essential part. So being able to know, to have correct information, available information in your own language, and adapt it to what you are able to know, and to communicate freely what are your preferences and how do you wish to be treated, that is essential.
There was a very provocative study presented at ASCO this year about a system to allow patients to send into the clinic to a nurse their symptoms and their side effects that they were experiencing. And instead of just waiting for their normal consultation time to come up, and that would allow the nurse to get action happening if they had bad pain issues or vomiting or whatever it was. And not surprisingly, of course, that meant that patients felt better. What was a bit surprising, perhaps, was that they also lived longer.
Yeah.
And I think that really underlines the importance of supportive care, is that if someone manages you, your pain well, then you get up out of bed and get moving. And you're more interested in coming for some more treatment than if your pain's totally out of control and you're disappearing into yourself.
Absolutely, and also depression, which is something that is sometimes underdiagnosed and undermanaged and treated, and can influence a lot also the rest of the treatment. So I think it was a very important study showing the improvement or in survival, so that they lived longer. Maybe that will open the eyes of a lot of people to continue to provide the best supportive care.
Well, thank you very much for spending some time with us here, Fatima, and you'll be spreading the word not only with patients and clinical trials, but also with the medical oncologists next week. So I'm sure they'll take on board your call to action.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.